Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the nice introduction and for giving me the opportunity to talk about our ongoing work. So, as you already heard, the topic of our work is about strain gauges and Meanders-shaped structures to compensate for temperature fluctuations. My talk will be structures as follows. I'll introduce you to the techniques used and why we have the motivation to do this, what we do. Then I'll talk about the concept of the nested design, and then I'll show some results on temperature compensation and conclude my talk. Okay, as everybody knows, the concept of printed electronics is more or less on the uprise constantly. Everybody talks about it, uses it in some extent, and it's more or less omnipresent. But nobody really knows about the techniques used to fabricate those. For example, two kind of industry style techniques would be flexographic and gravure printing. These are roll-to-roll fabrication techniques where large quantities can be printed. Inkjet printing, for example, is more or less a serial technique where you can print fine structures, can tune your structure to the degree of every sensor can be different, but it's a serial technique, so it's slow. Slot die coating, on the other hand, is fast, but is not available for various reasons. You cannot realize complex structures because it's, yeah, as you can see in the picture. Then rotary screen printing is actually similar to the gravure and the flexographic printing techniques, also a roll-to-roll fabrication technique, but with the difference that you can easily change your screens. And this brings me to the last one, which is flatbed screen printing. That's actually the reason the screen printing techniques I mentioned last is because we in the lab use mostly screen printing to fabricate prototypes, while the company we are working with is employing rotary screen printing to directly use our tests and our gained knowledge to employ in the factory. So, where do we put our sensors onto? This is kind of how the substrate with the sensor looks like. At first, you have sheet steel, which is then covered by a polymer layer, an organic polymer layer made of either polyethylene or polyurethane-based coatings. This has two functions. For one, I obviously need an isolation layer because sheet steel is conducting and I want to do sensors on top. And for other reasons, I need to have a leveling layer because of the surface roughness, which is inherent in the base material. Then next, the sensor elements are printed with various techniques. As I mentioned before, we mostly use screen printing, but we also tried inkjet. And last, the whole sensor structure is then covered again with spin coating or with wire bar printing of another organic material layer. The top organic material layer has actually also multiple functions. First, obviously, it's to cover up the electrically conducting layers so the sensor cannot be shorted or whatever. Secondly, it's also a mechanically stabilizing layer because this whole concept is bendable. I mean, it's not flexible, as in it would be on a polymer substrate, but it's bendable. And when you bend it, you need a mechanically stabilizing top layer to avoid cracking of your structures. Okay, and this is actually what the sensor looks like in real life, so a printed sensor. Here you can see multiple things there. Okay, so obviously there are two different strain gauges here visible. The black one is made of carbon black. It's screen printed carbon black paste employed by Henkel, so it's a commercial available screen print ink. While the what appears to be gold, but it's actually silver layer is silver screen print paste, also supplied by Henkel. And those two are printed in after following steps, so they are not printed at the same time, but they have to be printed one after another and are entangled into each other, which is what we call this nested concept. The line widths which you see here are actually 150 respectively 300 micrometers line width for silver and carbon black. The reason why the Carbon Black has a low resolution, also a higher sheet thickness, is due to the particle size, which is inherent in the Carbon Black ink. Therefore, we have to use bigger mesh screens, and that is actually what limits the resolution. So, the next concept, or another concept which we fabricated just to check on the concept we are trying to propose, is two different string gauges which are oriented perpendicular to each other and are placed right next to each other, but are both made of silver, just for fabrication, making the fabrication easier because we don't need two different materials here. And also a third structural design, which is also two string gauges, which are also oriented perpendicular to each other. But this time, in comparison to the first structure, the string gauges are entangled into each other again. So there's always alternating straight and perpendicular string gauges. Good. So after fabrication of the sensors, we obviously have to we have to characterize them. Therefore, we built an automated measurement setup where we have this is just a symbolic picture of the core components. We have a clamping system to realize a one-sided fixed bar setup where we mount our samples. Then we have a linear stage which actually moves the tip of the bar to introduce strain on top of the strain gauges. And then we have electronics to read out the resistance values. In this particular example, we just do four-wire measurements to characterize one strain gauge after the other. And all of this was done in a climate chamber with fixed conditions of 25 degrees and 50% humidity to ensure that we don't have any temperature perturbations, because obviously all of these structures would be temperature sensitive. Good. So for the experimental results we got, the first I am presenting here is silver, where you can see this actually are four different strain gauges as seen before in the picture. The difference being the geometrical values. So the line width was changed from 100 to 200, 300, and 400 micrometers, just to check whether or not the geometric differences make any changes or have an effect on the sensor performance. But you can clearly see here that it does not have any sensor alternating performance issues. And the linear fits, which are actually done for all four measurements, cannot be really distinguished from each other. So it's actually clearly shown here that the temperature coefficient, which is gained for silver, is highly linear and is very well measurable and characterizable. The whole measurement was done again in a climate chamber, where the temperature step was just adjusted by 10 degrees or from step to step, and each temperature step was then held for up to 1 hour to ensure that thermal set-in was ensured. And only the last 10 minutes of measurement data was then taken for evaluating the resistance value to ensure that no influence of the heat-up process was taken into account. And as you can see, silver has a pretty good temperature coefficient, which is comparable to a commercially available PT1000. So for the carbon black, it looks a little bit different, since carbon black is also, at first, it's visible that it's not PTC behavior, and it's also not linear in kind of the same way as the silver is. But that's explained through the fact that silver is obviously a metal and behaves like a metal, and carbon black is actually carbon particles behave more like a semiconductor, and also, yeah, don't form a homogeneous metal layer, so they are embedded into a polymer matrix. But also the same measurement conditions were applied, 1 hour per temperature step, and only the last 10 minutes were taken to ensure thermal set. And you can see that one can fit a narrow temperature range with a linear coefficient, and then extract a linear coefficient with a certain uncertainty, obviously. But obviously, One could also argue to fit this with a polymer of higher degrees, but linear is the way we went. I will get to that in the next slide where we did that. So for comparison of those two temperature coefficients, we only used 20 to 60 degrees because of the linear fit for carbon black, and yeah, silver was linear all the way through. We also characterized the gauge factor of those two structures, which you can see in the right plot. The gauge factor for carbon black was about 4.3, which is expected, but could be a little bit better, but we're working on improving that. I think it's due to the manufacturing steps involved, while the gauge factor of silver is about 1.74, which is also expected because metals would not exceed 2 anyway. So what do we do with this now? We extract two temperature coefficients, as said before. We extract the two gauge factors, as also mentioned. And then we apply a set of linear of equations to with actually which contain both the temperature and the strain. And now we measure temperature and strain with on the same sample and employ the known values which we extracted from measurements before. And then we can calculate out of these equations, because we just have to measure both resistances, then we can calculate the temperature as well as the strain that was applied. And this looks then something like this. So let me elaborate a bit on what we see here. At first, the sample on top here is clamped into the measurement device, but was not periodically excited, but was just at this point. You can see that strain was applied. So here you can see strain was applied and was held at a fixed position. The green line here actually is the employed theoretical strain. Then after the strain was applied, heat was introduced onto the sensor area, just in the middle of the sensor area. And one can see red corresponds to carbon black, while the light blue measurement corresponds to silver. Obviously, both of those strain gauges have an effect when they are heated up. So carbon black actually drops and silver actually rises in strain, in resistance, sorry. And what we do now is we apply the coefficients we measured before and we plug them into the linear equation system we had before. And the result of those linear equation systems, of this linear equation system, is actually the blue line you see here. This is a calculated strain approximation with the extracted coefficients we had before. And that is why we only approximated carbon black with a linear behavior, because if we would have a higher degree polymer, then we would not be able to use this kind of approximation. But as you can see, the approximated strain is rather correct or good. Okay, so that's for the compensated structure, and to check whether or not this is really possible, because what we employ here is that when we apply a heat on top of the structure, then we assume that the heat transfer through our steel substrate is big enough that both of the structures or both of the printed sensors get to equal thermal heat more or less quickly, and therefore we had these two initial tests structures. The first one, this one being corresponds to these two measurements, while the second one corresponds to these two measurements. And what we see here is we introduced a temperature change here on either this or this side, and what we see is that the half bridge actually also changes the output value, which is completely normal, because if you will change one temperature of a bridge resistance, you also change the measured value. But if we do the same with this entangled strain gauge, where you have alternating perpendicular strain gauges and you apply heat on top of it in the middle or wherever, then you can see that the applied heat actually does not really affect the output voltage of the half bridge setup in this case, and therefore we can ensure that the heat transfer through the substrate is sufficient. Okay, and with this I will conclude. So we demonstrated that screen printed strain gauges are feasible. We've also included temperature compensation, which just has to be, you have to only characterize your material, and then you can more or less do a mathematical correction of the temperature influence of the stream. Okay, and with that, I would like to thank my university, my team, the company and partner, and I'm open for your questions now.